Hello everybody. I wanted to read a little bit of this Rick and Morty module. And I also wanted to show you real quick how I've decided to do the maps, since with this map right here, and supposedly this is like an old school blue style map. This is all that you get. There's no other map in here. Some monsters in here in the back, which is nice. But I kind of wish they had done the artwork differently for this book. So, I wouldn't say that this book is like really well made, but I still like it. But as for the map, what I did is I went and found on Reddit someone had made a map that you could download that actually is quite detailed. And what I've done, instead of using like Roll20 and having to learn all that, I have a clip studio pane, and for some reason this camera doesn't really pick it up too well. This tablet, maybe it's because the type of screen protector I've got on it. But anyway, what I've done is blacked out everything. Even got like little enemies hidden here, and maybe one of the players will notice that these like little sturges. But yeah, so that's what I've done with this whole entire map. But what's cool about this map is the guy that made it. Actually put like a lot of details into this, unlike a lot of the other maps that I found online. So here's the mouth, and then this person actually put a mouth there. So that's pretty cool. What else was there? Yeah, there's like supposed to be all these beds here, so that's cool. This right here is supposed to look like a butt, which is really true. is the butt room. A pair of perfectly rounded stone mounds, cleft artfully straight down the middle. So it's supposed to look like a butt with a little treasure on top. So the person put this treasure on top, which is really cool. So stuff like that. So this map is really a nice map. And you can upload it to like Roll20 or Fantasy Grounds and stuff like that if you wanted to. But for me, I'm just using Clip Studio Paint. And I can screen share with my tablet. I wanted to read some of this here and just start out right here. So it's the Lost Dungeon of Rickedness. It goes without saying, but this is a great dungeon. How did the characters get here? Who cares? They're here now, and that's enough. Maybe this is all a bad dream or some hallucination brought on by eating gnarly shrimp. Are there safe places to take rests? That's up to you. Although, I say no rest for the wicked. What about the treasure the characters find here? Can they sell it anywhere? Are there things they spend their gold on? To that I say, isn't that acquisition of treasure? Isn't the acquisition of treasure the best part? There aren't any weird underground dwelling vendors here. But if the characters are persistent, perhaps some of the dank-ass dungeons, denizens, dungeon denizens will dine to do. So the general features, we've got, unless otherwise noted, the dungeon is well lit by magic. I'm getting into the wizards did it bullshit right off. So basically this is all Rick talking to you, the dungeon master. So like all this stuff he's saying is like talking to, well, since I'm reading it, talking to me. So there's like little things here. Hard to get a camera angle to be able to show everything, but not really clearly, but I'll just do this, I guess. So right here in parentheses, it's got, I'm getting into that wizards did it bullshit right off. So that's like Rick commenting a little bit. Rooms and hallways in the dungeon are made of stone. Ceilings are 20 feet high, doors are made of wood, and have AC 15 to 20 hit points, and immunity to poison and psychic damage. Unless the description of an area says so, all the doors in the dungeon are unlocked. Okay. Alright then. That's good to know. There are also not into humanoids, so don't try to seduce them. I know it's bad to do that with the book, but really, it doesn't matter anymore. I don't care about this one as much as I like the rule book. Some of these rooms might seem a little cramped if you compare the activities inside to the map. But it's magic, so like, the rooms are just sometimes bigger on the inside. I'm all about that D. That stands for dimensional transcendence, obviously. Oh, and once a room's been solved and passed, none of its features trigger again if the characters go back the way they came. Any monsters and NPCs hanging out in there might yell rude things, though. Leveling up. By the time they finish this dungeon, the characters should be third level, because they can wander around the dungeon in any kind of banana-ass circuitous route. As a general guideline, you can let them hit second level at about 30% of the way through the adventure. Then hit third level at about 70% of the way through. What if they die? First of all, if the characters die in the dungeon, great. Work as intended. Second, if the characters die, the players also die in real life. Third, that was a joke. Dead players are no fun for anybody. How are you supposed to lord your powers over corpses? Anyway, you can get creative about bringing back dead characters. One pro move is to take the dead character sheet, cross out the old name, and write a new name with like one letter different from before. That's the player's new character who suddenly steps in from the previous room. Carry on. The Lost Dungeon of Rickedness Locations. All the locations talked about in the adventure are from map 1.1, obviously. Let's get going already. Read the following right now. Just do it. So this is what I'm going to read to the characters. All this other stuff is just for me. Or the players. You're an adventurer. Or maybe you're even a group of adventurers. Whatever. Why are you here? No one cares. Don't tell me your backstory. We're here to kick ass and find treasure. That's your motivation. Now get ready to roll. Could have said like Rick roll, but I guess it's going too far. Maybe I could say it. In front of you is a dark staircase. Its mysterious shadow beckons you to enter. And by beckon, I mean you need to go down the staircase, or there's not a hell of a lot of purpose for us all sitting around this table, is there? That's a good start, right? No taverns or want ads or wizards begging you to retrieve the bauble of Plargleball. Which, by the way, is actually completely worthless to the Plargleballians. Total waste of your time. So the first room is a searching room. When the characters descend the stairs into this room, read the following to set the scene. This room is dark. It smells like a pet store. It's all wood chips and warm poop down here. A bunch of bats flap around the room. They look harmless. The bats aren't harmless. They're not even bats. They're hidden sturges. Are there sturges? Why did I do that? I said they're hidden sturges. Not cool. The characters aren't, like, super well hidden. These non-bats notice them and attack immediately. I wrote bunch in the description, but you should use at least 3 sturges. If you have more than 3 characters in your game, then add more sturges to match the character count, so all the characters can fight their own flying rodents and feel good about themselves if they kill one. Treasure. Anyone who searches the room who succeeds on a DC 12 wisdom perception check earns 35 silver pieces scattered around. Searching whether the characters find anything or not also makes their hands smell like sturge poo, which imposes disadvantage on their charisma checks and charisma saving throws until it's washed off. second room is the goblin room. As the adventurers approach this room, have everyone make a DC 12 wisdom perception check. Anyone who succeeds can hear two goblins talking in goblin about how their friend Jerry is a useless jerk. When the characters enter or peek inside the room, read this description. This room features a small wooden table and a couple of stools. Two goblins hang out here, looking pretty bored. Maybe they'd be less bored if they got into a life or death struggle with a few adventurers. Just a thought. One of the goblins is wearing an eye patch. Her name is Lake. The other goblin has a bad leg, and his name is Eye. If the characters are sneaky, they might be able to surprise these losers. Otherwise, if the party attacks, these gobbo-slobbos fight back. But before they both die, at least one flees to their pals in area. This room is sort of trapezoidal, with doors to the east, north, and south. It's also got statues kind of scattered around, mostly statues of Rick with inscriptions like, wow, damn. One of these statues depicts a woman in armor, really fine crafting. Most of the statues are pretty self-explanatory, but if a character examines the statues of the armored woman, read the following. At the base of the statue, the plaque reads, "Don't worry, I'm not a real person turned to stone. I'm just a cool-looking statue put here to intrigue you. It's probably nothing. You should pick a door. Let's move on." I think for this, like, if the characters ever came back to this room, even though it said earlier that nothing triggers, I would make, if you go back into the room, I would make this statue become an enemy. I think that would be cool. Nothing strong or anything. Well, maybe. Just depends on how, what level the characters are if they come back. Maybe like later on I'll have like something hinting for them to go back for some reason, but it's just a trap. A careful search accompanied by a successful DC wisdom perception check reveals a hidden compartment in the statue that holds a scrap of paper. Inspecting the paper reveals a note written in common. Quit wasting time. Pick a door and go. Flip a coin if you have to. Just pick a direction. It's not rocket science. What are you going to do? Spend the whole night standing in here with a statue? You need to pick a door and go. This is like the third fucking room. We don't have all day. Room number 4, Magic Mouth Room. This rectangular room conveniently conforms to a grid for easy map making. On the north wall is a big orange mouth. Oh, it's orange. Well, that doesn't look orange at all. About 8 feet high. Yeah, it's gross and weird. There's nothing else you can see in this room, and you're not really looking anywhere else because, I mean, what the F? It's a giant wall mouth. As soon as any character says anything out loud, the wall mouth interrupts by shrieking, "Surprise! Answer this riddle. You have to do it." SMHDWM. What's next in line? Solve this riddle and something cool happens. If you fail, it's bad. What's your answer? Especially in this, it has nothing to do with Rick and Morty or Dungeons and Dragons. So, the party has one chance collectively to answer the riddle. One. If they try to leave, the characters discover that the way out is blocked by an invisible wall that can't be attacked or dispelled by or anything. So, you remember that. Describe how their faces smush up against it, then laugh at them. You're supposed to be like a real dick in this. While they're trying to figure out the answer, pretend you're the big orange mouth and smack your lips a bunch. Get all the mouth spits out anything placed in it. If the characters are stupid enough to try destroying the mouth instead of answering, have any moron who attacks it get licked for 3 1d6 shame damage. That's right, shame. There's no resistance to shame. The solution? Oh, it's a good one. The answer is why. The pattern stands for second, minute, hour, day, week, month. Next in the sequence is year or why. That's just so terrible. Like, that's very, 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 very terrible. I think I'm just gonna look up a riddle about like a mouth or something mouth related or something, because it's a giant mouth. So what else kind of riddle would it be? And maybe I can twist it to be like a little nasty or like change the word to like a Rick and Morty kind of word. You know what I mean? So yes, pretty terrible. Really terrible. If any character answers correctly, which I doubt anybody will, the mouth smiles and magically hawks up 50 GP. If the party gets it wrong, which they most likely will, the mouth laughs and gives them the answer in a really smarmy voice. Then every item each character has except for their primary weapon vanishes. Armor, clothes, adventure gear, treasure, snacks, everything. All this equipment is teleported to the treasure room, Area 6. But the characters don't know that right now. Either way, the mouth then disappears and the invisible wall vanishes. This big old circular room features 6 bedrolls on the floor, a bunch of dice, and some parchment scattered around. Oh yeah, and 4 goblins are here. The 4 goblins are named Jerry, 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 and Jerry. If Leg and I from Area 2 fled here, all the goblins have grabbed their scimitars and set up an ambush. But around the entrance opposite the one the party comes through. If Leg or I didn't make it here, the characters catch the goblins off guard, even more off guard. So they get an advantage roll. I'm learning. The adventurers are naked. The adventurers are naked, most likely because of the mouth in Area 4, but for any reason really, the goblins have disadvantage on attack rolls in the first round of combat, as they giggle at the group's jiggly unmentionables. G&G nerds. At first glance, it might look like the goblins were gambling. But a successful DC 15 intelligence investigation check made to poke through the dice. Reveals that they were actually playing goblins and gizzards, their favorite tabletop role-playing game written in Goblin. Goblins and Gizzards is way better than D&D. Treasure. The goblins carry 20 GP, 35 SP, and the key to the treasure room, area 6. Some really good black hazelnut coffee. Their gaming setup also features a really nice set of 11 greenish yellow dice. Each die is worth 1 GP and comes with a lifetime of warm. So the dice they're talking about, I'll show you. Alright. Here they are. Oh, this is the Rick and Morty box. Actually, the one I want to show you is this one. Anyways, here are the dice that it's talking about. And unfortunately, when I got these, they're like, some of the blue is coming on a lot of them. I might actually just take these and like take a knife or whatever. Not even on camera. And start giving like little marks and put some dark black paint or whatever and make these look a little worn and used. Because, like we just read, they're from Goblin and Gizzards, and goblins are disgusting. I expect them to be. So their hands are probably very dirty all the time. So their dyes should be dirty. But yeah, I was talking about this before that bird interrupted me. I took a yoga mat and cut that dude up. And just set it inside this box, which is the bottom of the box that this module comes in. I call it a module, but it's a module, right? I think so. But I did it because around this box has some really good quotes, funny quotes and stuff around the whole thing, which I thought was really cool that they did that. And I thought immediately this would be a great dice box for the players and even for me. So, it works really well. I have a dice box that I made. I try to use things to their fullest potential and more. I guess I'm kind of a little bit creative that way, because I show these things to people and they think I would never think like that. But to me, it's kind of, it comes to me really quick. But I really like to make things that I have like lying around. Like when I made the books out of paper, out of cardboard. That was just something lying around, and I just thought, what could I do with that? And I thought about making a book, because it'd be really cool for Dungeons and Dragons, for everybody to have their own little character book to fill out. A book that's theirs, and not just a sheet. Alright, so enough with that huge. Get back to it. So we're on. Oh yeah, so. And the green and yellow dyes. Okay. I wish there were more to collect. That'd be cool. Alright, so we've got room 6, the treasure room. This dusty old room features a sweet ass treasure chest. You sense that bling is imminent. If the characters lost their clothes, armor, or other equipment when they failed to guess the wall mouse, really, really shitty riddle. In area 4, or flipped an unfortunate series of levers in area 31. I haven't gone through this whole book and done all the rooms yet on my tablet, so. Area 31 is new to me. This is where all their possessions ended up. If that happened, read this additional revelation. The stuff you lost when you effed up, that really obvious bit of adventuring, is all piled up neat, nice and neat, around the chest. If a character specifically asks to check for traps on and around the treasure chest, a successful DC 14 wisdom perception check reveals a trap built into the chest lid and determines that the trap can't be disabled. If the chest is open, the character opening it needs to make a DC 13 dexterity saving throw. As a screeching buzzsaw blade pops out of the chest. On a failed save, the blade slices the character right in the gut for 7 2d6 slashing damage. When someone opens the chest, get all quiet for a second and then make a loud buzzsaw screeching noise. Just do it. Scare the shit out. Treasure. Inside the chest is a glittery mound of treasure. 210 GP, 410 SP, 3 EP, 2 potions of healing, and a fake ruby that smells like fresh baked cherry pie. The ruby has a permanent prestidigitation spell cast on it that creates the bakery scent. The jewel doesn't do anything else, but feel free to make it seem more important than it really is. That's the true path of dungeon mastery. The seventh room, third goblin room. As the party approaches this room, pick a character at random and demand a wisdom perception check. If 10 or higher, they hear voices arguing beyond the door in what sounds like goblin, because it is goblin, and there are goblins in there. If the character opens the door, drop this on them. Two pissed off goblins chatter in their native language. Between them is the dead body of a third goblin. All of them look alike, so maybe they're related? Something for your noodle to bake on for a while. Behind them is a pile of glittering treasure, wealth beyond reckoning. It could be yours. Just deal with these goblins first. And remember, these are someone's mommy and daddy. Maybe. All three of these little monsters, living and dead, have armor and weapons. Once they notice the characters, they drag them into the argument too. These two goblins speak only a little common, so their speech is mostly goblin chittering with common words sprinkled in. Murder, treasure, a-hole, that kind of thing. Anyone who speaks goblin understands that the two goblins are accusing each other of murdering a third. So your players are a bunch of spongy, spiny Jerrys who want to play fantasy Sherlock Holmes instead of attacking? Fine. Let them try to interrogate the goblins and inspect the body. The goblins just chatter away angrily and blame each other for the murder. With a successful DC 10 intelligence investigation check, a character searching the body discovers coins scattered near its mouth. If they're gutsy enough to pry the dead gob's mouth open, they'll find it full of coins as well. If these observations are pointed out to the living goblins, they both act shocked. A hearty and successful DC 10 wisdom insight check reveals they're full of shit. A successful DC 12 charisma intimidation or persuasion check, all kinds of checks, then prize a confession out. The goblins switch immediately from being argumentative to being ashamed. In halting common, they admit that they dared their friend to swallow more coins than they did, around 100 GB for each of them. If the goblins demand they cough up the gold, if the characters demand they cough up the gold, the goblins try to make themselves vomit. This creates all kinds of terrible noises. But those coins are happy right where they are, in the tum-tum. If the characters still don't attack after that, the goblins flee the room, left alive to pass on their successful genetics and create more coin-eating idiots. The murder option, much better. Who cares who killed the goblin? They're all little monsters. Get rid of them. Jeez, I hate goblins. Every time you kill a goblin, somewhere out there, a Rick gets his wings. Nice work. If the gobs, so stupid. If the gobs from Area 5 are still breathing, they join in this mayhem after 1d4 rounds of combat. As the bodies hit the floor, they make a suspicious jingling sound. Treasure. The dead goblin has 200 GP inside them. If killed, each of the other goblins holds 100 GP in their stomach. All the rest of the glittering pile of treasure in the room turns out to be gold-wrapped chocolate coins, which aren't worth exactly squat. But likely would have been less fatal if in a coin swallowing contest. They are poisonous to dogs though, so don't mess around. The writer's room. This room's not done. The deadline really crept up on me, but don't sweat it. I've got a writer on it, and she's writing like her life depends on it, because it does. Lay it all down by reading the following. Everything in this odd-shaped room is white. The walls, the floors, the ceiling. Everything, that is, except the four doors and a stressed-looking lady. Seated at the cheap desk, writing furiously on paper. Or, how about parchment? And she's got an inkwell and a quill pen. How's that for immersion? A second after the doors opened, the room elongates until it's 100 feet long. If questioned, the writer, a commoner, explains that she's under a ton of pressure to finish writing this part of the dungeon. She has the power to shape the room based on what she writes on the parchment. Only what she writes. No one else can write on the parchment. Union rules. As long as she's able to write, she changes the room's shape and throws obstacles in the party's path. Those obstacles might be accidental to start with, including making the door disappear that the characters came in through just to get things rolling. But if the characters keep on bothering her, crazy shit starts to happen in earnest as the writer frantically writes intentional obstacles into the room to stymie the party. Once that happens, roll initiative. It's nothing personal, but she's not done with this assignment yet, and she really needs this job. To stop the writer, the character can kill or incapacitate her, or they can destroy the inkwell on the desk. The inkwell has an AC of 20. It's quite hard to hit, and 10 hit points. It's a nice inkwell. The writer can also be persuaded to stop writing with 3 successful DC 15 charisma persuasion checks. I'm gonna go drink a little bit more coffee. Because my stomach is just growling like crazy. Oh yeah, that's some real good coffee. Alright, so where are we? The writer can be persuaded to stop writing with 3 successful DC 15 charisma persuasion checks. It doesn't matter how many checks the characters fail while they try to get the writer on their side. On the first success, the writer appears to hesitate before continuing to write, and the room shrinks a bit. The second success indicates more progress, and she looks almost won over. On the third success, the writer throws down her quill, declares that work-life balance is essential, and triumphantly exits the room, never to be seen again. As long as she's able to write, though, the effects created by the writer make moving through this area a challenge for the characters. Malleable space. The room's normal force is reflected on the map. It reverts to that form if the writer is unconscious or leaves the room. But until that happens, the room looks nothing like what the map shows. The writer can use her inkwell and parchment to make the room any size she wants, up to 100 feet by 100 feet. But she defaults to transforming it into a 40 foot wide by 100 foot long tunnel to keep distractions away from her while she's working. She can also make the room's doors disappear or reappear at her whim. This could all probably be way simpler, but we're waiting until the writer's done with the adventure before telling her she has to redraw the whole damn map. How's she gonna draw an area that changes sizes? Maybe it's all an illusion. Whatever. At the start of each round, or whenever a character moves 10 feet farther into the room, the writer creates new obstacles from the fun obstacle table. So we've got, you roll a d12, you can either get a fire, geyser trap, freak out orbs trap, groovy Sturgis trap, hacky trap, like being drunk trap, million ants trap, mocking mouths trap, nasty pit trap, phantom gas trap, punch trap, spinning blades trap, tenderizer trap. Descriptions of each of these traps follow. Any active traps instantly end if the rider is no longer able to ride. Fire geyser trap. Whenever a creature ends its turn touching the floor in the room, roll a d20. On a roll of 10 or higher, fire erupts from the floor beneath that creature. The target must take a DC 12 dexterity saving throw, taking 7 2d6 fire damage on a fail save, or half as much damage on a successful one. Magic orbs appear, buzzing around the room and flashing psychedelic patterns that freak people out. Each creature in the room must succeed on a DC 12 wisdom saving throw or suffer the effect of a spectator's confusion eye ray. See page 42. Groovy Sturgis trap. A pipe descends from the ceiling, and 1d8 Sturgis fly out. The annoying creatures attack characters at random. Simultaneously, sick-ass beats fill the room. Any creature except the Sturgis that can hear the music succeed on a DC 12 wisdom check, saving throw, or give in to the music and start dancing. A dancing creature can't move from its space and has the disadvantage. Oh goodness. A dancing creature can't move from its space and has disadvantage on attack rolls and dexterity saving throws. While the creature is dancing, other creatures have advantage on attack rolls against it. A dancing creature can use an action attempt, a DC 12 wisdom saving throw. On a success, the effect ends and the creature can stop dancing. Hacky trap. Out of ideas, the writer throws a portal at the party. Each creature in the room must succeed on a DC 15 dexterity saving throw or be magically teleported back to the start of the room, thereby giving the writer some much needed time to keep working. So it's a hacky trap. Like being drunk trap. For 1d4 rounds, the whole floor heaves like when you're completely hammered. For as long as the floor pitches, each creature that starts its turn. I'm doing really bad right now. What's going on? For as long as the floor pitches, each creature that starts its turn standing on the floor must succeed on a DC 18 dexterity acrobatics check or fall on its ass prone. Million ants trap. 5 ants crawl out of cracks in the floor. Each round, a random character must succeed on a DC 12 dexterity saving throw or accidentally crush one of these ants. If they do, 9 more ants come pouring up out of the floor, gathering into a massive solid swarm that uses the ogre stat block and attacks. That's mocking mouth trap. Creepy mouths berate random characters, choosing a new target at the start of each round. The mouths mock the size of the target's weapons, their spell selection, their dumb stats, or their dump stats, or whatever in-game, out-of-game, or metagame topic catches their middle school bully-like attention. A targeted character must succeed on a DC 14 wisdom saving throw or suffer from low self-esteem, imposing disadvantage on attack rolls and ability checks until the start of the character's next turn. Nasty pit trap. The floor gives way under a random character. Its self-respect's greatest enemy falling over but weaponized into a trap. The target character and each character standing within 10 feet of the character must succeed on a DC 12 dexterity saving throw or fall into the 15 foot deep pit, taking 3d6 bludgeoning damage. To climb out of the pit and regain a dignity after falling, for literally the oldest trick in the Dungeon Master's Guide, a creature must succeed on a DC 10 strength athletics check. Phantom gas trap. There's a joke in here somewhere, but while the characters are off looking for it, a phantom fart loudly makes itself known. Each creature in the room must succeed on a DC 12 constitution saving throw or suffer a random effect from the fart gas table. God, I love D&D. Fart gas. Roll a d4. Sleep. The character falls unconscious for 1d4 rounds as if under the effect of a sleep spell. Retching. The character is poisoned for 1d4 rounds. Laughter. The creature is overcome by a fit of giggles because farts are fucking funny and is incapacitated for 1d4 rounds. Blindness. Something spicy in that fart leaves the creature blinded for 1d4 rounds. Punch trap. A goblin emerges from a trap door and punches a random character right in the groin. If the character needs to dodge, the character needs to dodge with a successful DC 15 dexterity saving throw or take a 2d4 bludgeoning damage. The goblin attacks once and then disappears back through the trapdoor, which immediately vanishes to leave no opportunity for counterattacks. Spinning blade trap. Slots in the walls open up and 6 round saw blades come flying out. Each blade makes one attack against a random character. Spinning blade. Ranged weapon attack, +3 to hit. Range 100 feet, 1 target. Hit for 1d8 slashing damage. Tenderizer trap. For the next 1d4 rounds, 5 foot diameter chunks of the ceiling fall at regular intervals, pretty much making the room a giant game of whack-a-mole. Each round, a random character is targeted by a smashy bit and must succeed on a DC 15 dexterity saving throw or take 3d6 bludgeoning damage. Treasure. A drawer in the desk contains three quarters empty bottle of scotch and a pack. It's really cool that pretty much the characters can almost go anywhere they want. Goodness. So like they can go to, once they get to room 3, they can go here. strength check or something, the character could go in here. I guess they are kind of forced once they go this way to be over here. But then, yeah, like right here, you can start going this way. Or go this way. Or, no, I guess. But anyway. It's pretty cool. And I think it would be a really good starter.